Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents 40 Verses to Ignite Your Faith, Surprising Insights from Unexpected Passages, by Laurie Polich Short. Narrated by Laurie Polich Short. For all who seek God and wisdom and hope and wonder where to go. Introduction. God can sometimes be missing from where we would like God to be. This observation keeps many people at a distance and can chip away at a believer's faith. After I wrote a book about my own experience of sitting in the silence of God, my inbox was filled with emails from people who needed encouragement in their waning faith. Jessica asked why she should hold on to God when it felt like God had let go of her. She spent 10 years serving in ministry, had her deepest prayer answered, then stripped away, and she wondered why God had abandoned her. All she heard was silence. Lauren asked if she should continue pursuing her dream career when she experienced rejection at every turn. She believed God was directing her, held fast to the encouragement of Bible verses, and solicited prayers from people who affirmed her call. So far, all she had been met with was a string of closed doors. David felt paralyzed by the scriptures he had memorized and taught to others that seemed to have failed him. As he watched friends receive the healing he himself longed for, he was envious and disturbed. He wondered why God seemed to overlook him while granting others the desires of their hearts. From these conversations, the same questions kept surfacing. Why do the verses I read in the Bible fail to come true in my life? How can I have confidence that God is near when my experience is that God is far away? Are there any scriptures that can speak to my experience of being fearful and disappointed and encourage me to hold on to faith? That last question was the impetus behind this book. For years, when I've spoken at conferences, people have said to me, "You highlighted a verse in the Bible I've never seen before." Enough of these comments showed me there was a need for someone to write about the lesser-known scriptures that often go unnoticed. Be careful when you think someone should do something. It may end up being you. In this book, I have sought to expose new or glossed-over verses that give us a better understanding of how God works. I have discovered that it is in the in-between verses, the ones that whisper rather than shout, that some mysteries about God become a little clearer. My hope is that the insights in this book will provide you with new confidence when you experience the fear, disappointment, and silence that play an integral part of your relationship with God. The lesser-known scriptures that we pass over help us discover new angles that can breathe life into our faith. I believe there are times when God may be willing to temporarily risk your belief in order to deepen your understanding, for the purpose of ultimately strengthening the relationship you have. So if you've ever been in a place where you wondered if you could even believe anymore, you may be closer to God than you think. Read on and discover why. Chapter 1. The Subtle Insertion of Doubt. Genesis chapter 3, verse 3. But God did say, "You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." If you read this verse too fast, you'll miss it. But if you look closely, you will see the moment where doubt begins. The response from Eve to the serpent reveals how the strength of our faith is undermined or enforced by our perspective of the way God works. The serpent's motive seems clear from the start, evident in the way he phrases his question. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Genesis 3:1. Looking back at Genesis chapter 2, verse 17, you can see the difference between the serpent's words and the boundaries God actually gave. There was one tree God asked Adam and Eve to refrain from. It was the first opportunity given to humanity to exercise free will. By introducing this choice, God gave Adam and Eve their first chance to obey. This raises the obvious question. Why did God put that tree there to begin with? Because without it, Adam and Eve would be left with only previously selected alternatives, and offering a choice is the only way to introduce human freedom. In the garden, we see God setting the stage to woo rather than control humanity. Had God created a world without choice, Adam and Eve would be puppets for God to program, rather than human beings for God to love. But the doubt-planting serpent takes God's gift of freedom and twists it, attempting to make the restriction bigger than it is. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree? The serpent knows what humanity has been discovering ever since. The bigger God's withholding feels, the more we are apt to succumb. Why doesn't God make room for what I want to do? We silently ponder. And if we dwell on these thoughts, our perspective of God morphs into a pleasure restrictor, dead set on keeping us from our longings. We become like teenagers who question parental boundaries and conclude that their parents are out to ruin their lives. Then they grow up and become adults and realize their parents were out to save their lives. Becoming an adult may be just what God is after in our souls. Our longings can range from companionship to provision, success to pleasure, and the quick answers to all these things dangle in front of us with only teeny compromises to overcome. We even become emboldened by focusing on God's unreasonable commands and use his denial of seemingly good things as motivation to plow ahead. Meditating on what happens next in these verses can help us turn the tide before it's too late. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The serpent hisses, laying his picture of God as a tyrant out for display. Eve starts her response nobly, remembering immediately those were not God's words. But her memory of God's restriction adds words that show the wedge her doubt has begun to make. God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. With this small added phrase, Eve chooses to highlight and build upon what she cannot do. Rather than focusing on the life-giving reasoning behind the directive, the restrictive piece of God's command is emphasized and enlarged. Oh, how we have been there. The coworker who edges closer and treats you better than your spouse does. The drink offered at a well-deserved celebration in the midst of your recovery from addiction. That moment you want to shout out, "Why would God put this delicacy in front of me?" and then expect me to refrain? This is where the trouble begins, and where the mindset of trust starts to decline. What happens next is fast, and unless we take our time looking at Eve's process, we wonder how she decided to disobey so quickly. Her eyes are taken off God's benevolence and care and directed instead to the fruit of the forbidden tree, and that tree becomes her primary focus in the garden. It's like lingering at a bakery window, trying to muster up the strength not to go in, instead of making the best first choice of just looking away. The choices get harder as we go, making our focus the first real battleground. Two verses later, Eve eats. Then she gives it to Adam, who you can note is with her, and he eats too. Such a small thing, eating from that tree. We may even feel that God shouldn't have made the tree's presence in the garden so tempting for them. How quickly we can move from accepting responsibility for our actions to blaming God for setting the stage for our choice, even though the consequences were shouting to us from the start. Sleep with that coworker and your marriage will never be the same. Take that drink and your recovery will be set back. Lie to a loved one and your trust will always be questioned. With the largeness of grace, there are always second chances, fresh starts, and new beginnings. But the consequences of not listening to God take up residence in our resumes. Those consequences move from their place in God's warning to being dealt with in our lives. And we now have to live with the unwanted garments our actions have brought us. Whether these garments are brokenness, addiction, heartbreak, or loss, we now have a new understanding of sin and separateness born by our experience. Thankfully, the God of second chances takes our tattered resumes and invites us to become spokespeople for why God deserves our trust. And when we speak of what we now know by experience, it helps those who hear our testimonies choose wisely, and it reinforces the strength of our future faith, especially when we can't see the immediate appeal in the right choice. Reflection. Number one, what is the strongest temptation you've had to do something you knew you shouldn't do? Can you track the process of the temptation? Number two, is there a longing or desire you are living with right now that is causing you to doubt God's goodness? Number three, how does Genesis chapter 3, verse 3 speak to the way you perceive God's boundaries? Does this reflection challenge you, or does it enforce what you already believe? Chapter 2. Moving ahead of God's timing. Genesis chapter 16, verse 2. Sarah said to Abram, "The Lord has kept me from having children. Go, sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her." She has waited long enough. Living endless days with an unmet longing has caused her glimmer of hope to move her to urgency. She can no longer sit in the silence of her prayer. She heard the promise God gave her husband and likely celebrated that an heir would finally come. As months have turned into years, however, Sarah questions whether God's strategy for causing this birth to happen might include her assistance. Sarah is my girl. When the going gets tough, the tough take control, especially when the perfect solution is directly in your view. Her thought process is not unlike our own. During a long season of waiting or suffering, we may see a vision for how things could change, so we rush in and grab it. We spiritualize our actions by thinking, "Surely God needs my help," and subtly manipulate our circumstances to achieve a desired end. Years spent waiting with an unmet longing can subdue our faith, and we subconsciously begin to believe that life only becomes what we make it. Our prayers move from "God, do what only you can do," to "God, bless me as I do it," and we slowly drift to a functional atheism. Perhaps Sarah has not gotten to that point. But the disappointment she feels toward God is clear in the language she uses. "The Lord has kept me from having children." There are so many ways she could have stated her condition, but the way she describes herself reveals what she believes, and maybe, more importantly, what she can't believe because of it. Trusting a God who has allowed disappointment and despair requires a big faith. Many of us are tempted to give up hope, yet God urges us on with opportunities to trust. The Bible reveals that we have a God who will pull out all the stops for us to experience the largeness of His presence, even after we've attempted to shrink Him out of our lives. It seems God longs, almost desperately, for us to see how big of a God we have and what He is able to do. God knows that when things happen when we want them to happen, we celebrate. But when things happen after we think it's too late for them to happen, we worship. Only when it's too late, too hard, or flat out impossible does God have the opportunity to emerge from the mist and come spectacularly into view. God had proclaimed to Abraham that this heir would come to him from Abraham's body. See Genesis chapter 15, verse 4. Sarah's body is not specifically mentioned in the promise, leaving room for the alternative that she suggests. Perhaps Sarah thought God meant that Abraham was supposed to have this child through their maidservant. Building a family through wives and maidservants was perfectly acceptable in that culture. We see examples of it throughout the Old Testament. So it's important to note that Sarah is not suggesting anything deviant or wrong in her solution. I imagine the fact that Hagar was a servant in their household when Abraham got his promise may have even spurred Sarah into thinking that is why she is here. God wants her to help. On they went with the plan, Abraham consenting without a fight. I have often pictured him when Sarah suggested it. Really, sweetheart? Sleep with that beautiful younger woman? I'm guessing there was at least some appeal for Abraham, made evident by his quick response. Abraham agreed to what Sarah said. Both of them must have felt they could not wait any longer for God to fulfill his plan, so they decided to fulfill it for him. God allowed their plan to move forward, suggesting that his sovereignty and our actions mysteriously coincide. This dance between God's sovereignty and human will is evident in the presence of all sorts of things that seem outside of God's will, that are nonetheless present in our complex world. The stories in the Bible illustrate that God's overall plan is secure, but the way we get there includes our participation. So, what clues to the mystery of God's actions and our responses do we find hidden in these verses? First, God is revealed more in what he doesn't do and allows than in what he does do and doesn't allow. We see here that we have freedom to move ahead of God in his timing, which seems like an oxymoron, since God is everywhere at once. Nevertheless, we exist within the confines of time, and God often uses his timing to increase our faith. By giving Abraham this promise of an heir, and then waiting more than 10 years to deliver it, God was giving Abraham, and especially Sarah, an unwelcome opportunity to stretch their trust. This verse reveals their inability to continue waiting as the number of their years raced ahead. I have lived their desperation, and I imagine that you have lived it too. Somehow waiting is necessary to grow our faith, and our increasing faith is what God desires most. This is an ongoing lesson because even when we see God deliver the impossible after a long wait, we don't usually welcome that opportunity again. Rarely have I beseeched God to slow down, with the exception of when I'm looking in a mirror as I age, but the times I've beseeched God to speed up are too numerous to count. When time goes on and I hear silence, like Sarah, I fill God's silence with my own solutions. Often those solutions even carry spiritual undertones as I pray God's blessing on my process in moving ahead. This verse, read in context with what happens next, encourages me to go another route. Abraham and Sarah's move eventually does incur God's voice, but it is directed to Hagar after their plan goes awry. But this dear couple eventually sees that grace prevails, even in detours. With a second chance to produce a promised heir, even after the fallout of their actions, Abraham and Sarah discover that God's overall plan is not derailed when we go our own way. This is especially comforting to those of us who have taken detours ourselves and wonder if good can still come. Reflection. Number one. Where have you most recently experienced waiting in God's silence? Number two. Are you tempted by a solution that seems less than perfect, but is something you may settle for because you can't wait any longer for God to show up? Number 3. How does this story speak to your own life and situation right now? Chapter 3. Never Alone. Genesis chapter 16, verse 13. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. Her fate seems to be sealed. The people she has served have used her. She has been a pawn in her employer's quest for control. There is no story that captures the heart of someone who has been used, abused, or unfairly treated more than the story of Hagar. But it is Hagar's declaration that gives us our hope. You are the God who sees me. Hagar speaks these words in the middle of the desert, in the middle of being cast out, in the middle of quieting the cries of her starved, pregnant belly. She was compelled by her mistress, Sarah, to become impregnated by Sarah's husband, and now unwillingly carries a baby she'll be forced to give up. When Sarah realized Hagar was not a happy participant in her ploy, she complained to Abraham about Hagar's attitude. He told her to do with Hagar whatever you think best. Verse 6. These dismissive words were all that are recorded from the man Hagar gave herself to, the one whose seed is growing inside her. And with Abraham's permission, Hagar was mistreated, possibly even beaten until she ran away. This is not a flattering scene in Abraham and Sarah's story, but it is an important one. It reveals that God follows the marginalized, even in the middle of a story about someone else. The fact that this chapter in Genesis follows Hagar into the desert, rather than staying with Abraham and Sarah in their pregnancy quest, shows us that God is concerned about those who have been used, abused, or discarded by others. This story speaks to the loyal employee who is suddenly fired, or the spouse who gives her best years to her husband, only to be replaced. Perhaps it even dares to reach out to those who have had their bodies and lives stolen in terrible and secret ways, and who wonder if there is anyone out there who knows their plight. You are the God who sees me. Even if no one else knows what I have been through, I can have hope you are there. These words are the gift Hagar gives to our faith, faith in the God who follows her in her difficulty. God pursues Hagar in that desert and begins a conversation with her through an angel so that she knows he is there. Then God gently allows her to pour out her heart about her injustice and foreseeable fate. Hagar can't see her way out of the despairing circumstances that surround her, and she doesn't know what God sees about the way her circumstances will unfold. Tenderly, the angel speaks words of promise to Hagar about her child's future, and although the prophecy about her son is not all good news, it points to a new chapter of life and hope. Hagar's story will not end in the desert, and her boy will be hers to raise. This is a future and a joy for which she never could have hoped. You are the God who sees me, Hagar cries out, and it becomes a cry for all of us when we feel lost and alone. Our story won't be merely what we see in this set of current circumstances, and there will be both joy and sorrow as our future unfolds. We live the good and bad of others' choices as well as our own, but we are never alone. Hagar would not leave the desert and have a perfect life. Suffering and joy are part of the human experience, but Hagar's words reveal that we do not face any of these things alone. God is our company in our sufferings. Hagar's encounter with the angel in the midst of her despair affirms that truth. There is another angle to this story, what it reveals about God's sovereignty. Here in this complicated story of Hagar, Abraham, and Sarah, we discover that God writes his story with us, not apart from us, and he includes the messiness of our choices in the way his stories unfold. While God's ultimate will for a son to be born to Abraham and Sarah is not shaken, Hagar's son will be grafted into their unfolding story. Given the history of the Arabs and Israelis following these two births, it would be easy to conclude that God's story would have been cleaner and simpler if Hagar had died in that desert, or if Ishmael hadn't been born. But this account reveals the inclusion of human intervention in our stories of faith. God preserves our freedom and gives grace to the victim, and he includes our mistakes in the outcome rather than wiping them out. One wonders what happens after the angel tells Hagar to go back, submit to Sarah, and have her baby. I imagine as the years pass, Sarah may soften toward Hagar, possibly when her own eventual pregnancy takes place. One thing we know is true. The fact that this sidebar is included in the grand Genesis story reveals the important fact that God doesn't sweep away our messes. He includes them for how they will instruct us and others in our walks of faith. Abraham and Sarah are still used by God in spite of their mistakes. Hagar is not forgotten in her pregnancy. And this short encounter between Hagar and the angel in the desert is a sweet reminder of the way God pursues us when we feel lost. We are not alone or abandoned in our sufferings. The God who sees us will put us on a path to find our way home. Reflection. Number one. Where do you need to know you are seen by God right now in your journey? Number two, have you ever felt used or abandoned by people you loved or served and wondered if God cared? How does Hagar's story encourage you? Number three, have you experienced a wrong turn in your life that you or someone else made, that God included and recalculated in your spiritual journey? If so, when? Chapter 4. Remembering and Living Our Weights. Genesis chapter 41, verse 1. When 2 full years had passed, Pharaoh had a dream. When 2 full years had passed, Genesis chapter 41 opens, and we immediately move on in the passage to what happens next. But taking a minute to live in that phrase helps us appreciate the actual time needed for our stories to unfold. The story of Joseph can encourage us in a different way when we pause over verses like this one, especially when we consider what it took to actually live the story out. The problem we can have with many of the Bible's faith stories is that we hear them in a 30-minute sermon or Bible study, and feel the rush and excitement as we watch God move. But we forget to take in the immense weight that lives in these 6 small words. When 2 full years had passed. For 2 years, Joseph lived, forgotten, in a jail cell. 2 years of checking off monotonous days and nights that passed without end. And let's not forget the word full in case 2 years passes too quickly off your tongue. Some things that need to happen in our lives can only be accomplished through time. When God wants to work in us, through us, or around us, these time lapses are integral for how our stories will unfold. Joseph's circumstances shaped his character to prepare him to be the leader he would one day become. and having to persevere in his trial was the only way these character qualities could be developed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.